SpaceX's Big Catch and Hubble's Cosmic Fossil. You're listening to Are We There Yet? The radio show exploring space exploration. Hi, I'm Brendan Byrne. After a test flight of SpaceX's Starship, the company was able to snatch its giant booster out of the air. But what's the catch with the catch? We'll speak with Ars Technica space editor and author Eric Berger about the engineering feat and what it means for the future of SpaceX. Then, Hubble has been very busy exploring our universe. From monitoring Jupiter to exploring so-called cosmic fossils, the more than three decades old telescope continues to collect data about our universe. We'll speak with Hubble's Jennifer Wiseman about the telescope's recent discoveries and investigations. That's ahead on Are We There Yet? SpaceX once again launched its gigantic Starship rocket on a test flight.
3, 2, 1.
We have lift off. But this time, arms at the launch pad caught the first stage booster. It's an incredible feat for the aerospace company. Here to put it into context is Eric Berger, space editor at Ars Technica and the author of two books, Liftoff and Reentry, both examining the history of SpaceX. Eric, welcome back to the show.
Thanks, Brendan. Good to talk to you again.
So, Eric, since we last spoke, SpaceX had a pretty remarkable test flight of its Starship. I know the chopsticks and the midair catch headlines, but let's take one step back here and talk about the purpose of this test flight and the significance of its success. Why did SpaceX do this test flight in the first place?
Well, the primary reason was to demonstrate the ability of reusability for the first stage of the rocket. The first step toward that is you have to get the rocket back, and you have to refurbish it, and then you have to refly it. And what they demonstrated really for the first time recently was catching the rocket in midair. That was remarkable because we'd never really seen anything like that before, where a rocket just has really this very precise hovering and right where it needs to be for the launch tower to essentially grab it from midair. They've taken a big first step toward reusing that stage, and we'll see where they go from here.
It was a marvel of engineering, was it not? I mean, to see this massive booster literally hovering in front of the launch pad and then being caught by the launch pad itself. I mean, tell me a bit about just how complicated and complex a maneuver like this actually is.
When you look at their drone ship landings, right, with the Falcon 9 first stage, the drone ship is about 300 feet long and 150 feet wide. So they've got it's not a big target, but it's a target. And this rocket is coming back and landing, you know, within a few feet of this massive launch tower, which probably cost at least several hundred million dollars for SpaceX to build, probably more, and all sorts of valuable ground infrastructure. If you watch it, it kind of comes in and like literally it has maybe a foot of wiggle room on either side as it comes down precisely where it needs to be for the arms to grab onto it. So from an engineering standpoint, the precision required in those kinds of flight algorithms is pretty astounding.
And why even go through that? As you mentioned, it is precision. They have landed boosters quite successfully, both at land and on a barge at sea. Why is it necessary for Starship and Super Heavy to be caught by the launch pad itself?
That really is the great question and the big question, because it sure looks cool, but they didn't do it for that reason. It was as awesome as it looked, it's even more practical. When a Falcon 9 rocket lands today, you know, if you watch it, in the last seconds, you see these landing legs extend and come down. And there's powerful actuators that are driving that. There's hydraulic fluid. There's the mass of the landing legs itself. This is not an insignificant amount of mass. And so basically, the mass that you're taking away from the first stage is not pound for pound, but it is a ratio of that you're losing on your payload to orbit. And it's significant. With Starship, the landing legs are going to have to be even bigger, the first stage, because it's a much bigger rocket than the Falcon 9. So you're talking about like tons of equipment, structures, and actuators to drive this that you're just adding on to the vehicle. The first rule of rocketry is to make that launch vehicle as light as possible. Not having landing legs is huge. And the other big thing, and I think just as significant, if not more so for SpaceX, is they want to eventually reach airport-like operations with Starship. You know, right now between Falcon 9 launches, they're down to about 3 weeks. part of the problem is if you landed on a drone ship, it takes about a week to get back into port, and you have to offload it and transport it back to the factory or hangar in Florida and refurbish it and fly it again. In this case, they're literally taking Starship, they're catching it as it comes back from space, and an hour or two later, they're setting back on the launch mount where it took off from. And so if they can get to the point where only a moderate or minimal amount of refurbishment is needed to that rocket, you have completely removed all of that transportation and processing of the vehicle that you had from either the landing site or the drone ship.
So while it looks cool, this is absolutely for practical purposes.
It absolutely is all bent toward the idea of rapid reuse and making the rocket with as little mass as possible so you can maximize what it can put into space.
Eric, the last time we had you on the show, we talked about your book Reentry, which chronicles these later chapters in SpaceX's history, especially when it comes to booster landing. How much of that history and knowledge that SpaceX learned from Falcon 9 landing and really making that something that happens quite regularly, how much did that go into being able to pull this off with the catch?
It was essential. I mean, if you go back and look at the first rockets that SpaceX landed, they were the Falcon 9 full thrust. Those flew at most once or two more times after they landed. Then they took all of those learnings and put it into their final iteration of the Falcon 9 called Block 5. And now we've seen those rockets fly more than 20 times. So they're taking all of that learning and putting it into Starship. And you have similar people still involved. Like, you know, Lars Blackmore was essential to developing the algorithms that helped the Falcon 9 basically fly back through the atmosphere safely, and he's working on Starship. You know, Shanna Diaz led the Grasshopper program that did the landings, and now she's the head of engineering for Starship. So the engineers at the company learned an enormous amount of Falcon 9. They've landed more than 300 times, and they're just able to take all of those lessons learned, some of which were pretty difficult lessons, and put it into Starship.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but those first Starhopper launches were what? 2019, and SpaceX has now made it to this incredible feat in 2024. I mean, that's 5 years. That is extraordinarily fast in engineering and development, is it not?
Yeah. If you remember, we had the first, the Starhopper launches were in mid-2019, and those went up, I think the second one went to about 150 meters. And yeah, to be where we are now with essentially an operational orbital rocket and now to be working on reuse is quite remarkable when you consider the size and the scale of the vehicle. And I think it's also the fact that, you know, they haven't just built one of these, right? They've got them lined up down there in South Texas. And so I think we're going to start seeing them launch every month or two pretty quickly.
The booster, incredible milestone there, but what about Starship on this particular mission? How did the vehicle itself do, and is it in line with where Starship needs to be to help get astronauts to the moon?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we don't have a lot of data about Starship. All we really know for sure is that the vehicle was mostly intact, and it landed almost exactly where SpaceX intended it to land in the Indian Ocean. So they clearly were maintaining good control of the vehicle all the way down. Over the next several months, I think they're going to have to figure out how they're actually going to try to return a Starship to land so that they can recover the vehicle and sort of get better eyes on it. I think a big question is how quickly reusable that vehicle is going to be, because it's got like thousands of tiles on it, kind of like the space shuttle did. So how much refurbishment is going to have to be done to those tiles? And I don't think we're going to really know that until SpaceX gets one of these vehicles back and can study it closely. At the end of the day, I don't think a reusable upper stage is essential for the Artemis program. The fact of the matter is SpaceX can build these upper stages pretty cheaply, probably on the order of $10 to $20 million. And so if they're getting the boosters back with all of the engines, 33 engines, I think that it's going to take lots of Starship missions to do an Artemis mission. But again, if they're building those upper stages pretty cheaply, I think they can get away with them being expendable for a while. Now, that's not SpaceX's goal. They clearly want to reuse the upper stage as quickly as possible, and I think it will take quite a bit of time to get there.
That cost, though, I mean, that was intentional from the start, right? SpaceX picked certain materials because of how inexpensive it was, right?
Well, yeah, that's exactly right. They went from very expensive composite tanks to stainless steel. And so they're literally buying, you know, industrial rolls of steel and hammering them or rolling them into these barrels that are the tanks for Starships, both first and second stage. And from a construction standpoint, it is pretty cheap. And, you know, oftentimes the really expensive part of a rocket is the engine, but they have brought down the production of the Raptor engine to below $1 million, which for a rocket engine is extraordinarily cheap.
Eric, you know, throughout this flight and the days leading up before it, we saw some conflict between SpaceX and the FAA. I'm wondering if you can briefly, and I know that'll be a challenge, explain the beef between the two organizations and, you know, have they ironed out their differences?
The fundamental problem, well, there's a couple of fundamental problems. Fundamental problem number one is Elon Musk does not like regulation, fights it famously, infamously, right? However you look at it. But he does not like government agencies or anything really that slows down the speed at which he would like his companies to move. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is that the FAA was built for an era when there were maybe a dozen launches a year from the United States. And now SpaceX is coming along and they're pushing their cadence. You know, they've already launched more than 100 times this year with the Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy rockets. And then you've got this Starship vehicle, which is just something that the FAA has really never had to deal with in terms of the potential. It's so big, right? It kind of shatters their models for potential damage on the ground. So the FAA isn't built to regulate these kinds of problems. They have been very public about saying that they're having trouble getting enough staffing to deal with it. And I think that it's not really designed to handle an iterative program like Starship, where there is some failure expected up front to really get to a rapid cadence of launches. So on the one hand, there's Elon and his desire to go fast and his disdain or strong dislike for regulatory agencies like the FAA. On the other hand, you've got an agency that, as I say, is not built for this. And the friction is everyone wants these missions to happen. Like I don't buy into the conspiracy theories that Joe Biden or Kamala Harris or someone else is up there saying, we're going to slow this company down. It's bureaucracy meeting innovation, and bureaucracy is winning. And so I think the FAA recognized the problem, but really this is something that Congress needs to step in and fix. And we're seeing some interest in that, but it's just not moving fast enough to really meet the needs of what SpaceX wants to do.
I want to talk a bit more about Artemis. As you mentioned, Starship is moving closer to having that happen, but you wrote last week in a piece for Ars Technica, it's increasingly unlikely that humans will fly around the moon next year. What is slowing down NASA's Artemis program currently?
Right. So for a couple of years now, you and I have both been tracking the heat shield problems on the Orion spacecraft, right? After it came back from its initial uncrewed test flight at the end of 2022, there was much more damage to the heat shield than NASA engineers or their modeling expected. And that obviously raised concerns. Now, if crew had been inside that vehicle, they would have been perfectly fine. But when you start to see more damage to a critical function like the heat shield, which protects the crew during their return to the atmosphere, you get pretty concerned. And so NASA has been slowly and methodically working through that issue, trying to understand why the damage occurred and whether it can be ameliorated by a different angle of reentry. And so I think they're probably going to end up coming back at a more steep reentry. But, you know, there was an independent review board that was tasked to look at this summer. Supposedly, they finished their report, but, you know, we're now in October and NASA hasn't said anything about that. They're very tight-lipped. Ultimately, I think that will get resolved, but I'm not sure that happens in time for September of next year. The new thing that we learned, and which I reported on last week, was a report from the U.S. Government Accountability Office, a congressional investigatory agency. And they found that the ground systems at Kennedy Space Center to support the launch tower, the software, and all of that, they had several months of schedule margin at the beginning of this year for a launch next year. And at this point, they don't have any schedule margin left. And so with about 11 months to go and no schedule margin, you've got to believe that the ground systems probably aren't going to be ready to support that kind of a launch either. And then there's finally the fact that they haven't started stacking the rocket yet. So it was supposed to begin last month. So all of this points to very likely Artemis 2 moving off its September 2025 date, probably later in the year, or more likely even to 2026.
We can speak with Eric Berger. He's a senior space editor at Ars Technica and author of two books, Liftoff and Reentry. Eric, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Still to come, what do black holes, globular clusters, water on Mars, and cosmic fossils all have in common? They're all being photographed by the Hubble Space Telescope.
A globular cluster is held together by the gravity of these close together stars, but they don't collide together because they have a lot of random motion. So think of it like a beehive.
The latest scientific findings from Hubble, that's ahead on Are We There Yet? You're listening to Are We There Yet? I'm Brendan Byrne. For over 30 years, the Hubble Space Telescope has been gathering images from space with the goal of understanding how our universe was formed and what's happening in our own galaxy and beyond. And recently, it's peered even closer to home. From water on Mars and cosmic fossils to black holes, Hubble has been extremely busy trying to collect images and data in deep space. Here to talk more about Hubble's activities and some of the telescope's recent missions is Jennifer Wiseman, the Hubble Space Telescope Senior Project Scientist. Jennifer, welcome back to the show.
Thank you. Glad to be back.
So Hubble has been very busy, as usual, from images of galaxies to even closer to home, like images of Jupiter. I want to talk first about a cosmic fossil that Hubble spotted. Tell me, first of all, what is a cosmic fossil and why is this so exciting to scientists like yourself?
A cosmic fossil is just basically a term we use for something that indicates something that happened in the past. So cosmic fossil would be something in space that gives us a hint about some characteristics of things in the past.
Tell me a bit about this particular so-called cosmic fossil.
One particular globular cluster that we refer to as a cosmic fossil is called NGC 2005, and it's actually not in our Milky Way. It's in our little satellite neighbor galaxy that's called the Large Magellanic Cloud. So when we look at the stars in this cluster, we're seeing what that little galaxy next to our Milky Way was like early on in its existence. And what we find is that the composition of stars in that particular globular cluster is a little bit different from the composition of the other stars around it in the Large Magellanic Cloud. And that means that probably the Large Magellanic Cloud is the product of at least one merger where there were more than one of these adolescent galaxies that actually merged together. And this is a fossil relic that's telling us that that happened because the globular cluster stars have a different composition than the stars around it. A globular cluster is held together by the gravity of these close together stars, but they don't collide together because they have a lot of random motion. So think of it like a beehive. The reason we think of globular clusters sometimes as fossils is because they tend to contain some of the oldest stars in the galaxy. So we think that our Milky Way galaxy is probably something like 12 billion years old. I mean, the whole universe is only a bit over 13 billion years old. So the galaxies started forming early on, and we think that's true for our Milky Way. However, stars have come and gone throughout those 12 billion years, so that our sun, for example, is not a first generation star, and it's only been around a few billion years. So our sun and other stars like it have not been around as long as our whole Milky Way galaxy has been around. However, these globular clusters of stars tend to contain stars that are just about as old as the galaxy itself. So these stars can be 10, 12 billion years old. And so when we look at them, we're learning something about the chemistry of the galaxy when it was very young.
I've got to say, Jennifer, globular clusters, they sound delicious for some reason to me, don't they? Like try Raisin Bran now with globular clusters. So it sounds fun. So Hubble's also looking deep into our cosmic past. It's also looking at our solar system neighbors. Can you tell me a bit about some of the recent observations that Hubble's made of Jupiter?
Hubble, because we've had Hubble for decades now, Hubble has been looking back at the outer planets and seeing if their atmospheres change, if their weather changes. And of course, the answer is yes, they do change. So in particular, we've been looking at that great red spot on Jupiter for decades, actually. And we've been finding things about it that are interesting. We know it's a big storm, a big hurricane-like storm, which I know folks in Florida aren't thinking very positively about hurricanes, but Jupiter has its share of them. The great red spot seems to be a giant hurricane. It's bigger than planet Earth. But by watching it over decades, we have found that storm is shrinking. It's actually getting smaller. The winds inside of it are speeding up. There are other storms on Jupiter cropping up. And most recently, we found that the storm, the Great Red Spot, kind of oscillates in the sense that it's like a little globe of jello that squeezes in one dimension, and then while the other dimension squeezes out like a stress ball. ball if you were squeezing a stress ball, and then it'll stretch out in the other direction and squeeze in the first direction. So it's kind of an interesting facet of the storm with its ever-changing dynamic winds going back and forth. So it's that little oval that we see on Jupiter is episodically getting fatter and skinnier over and over again as it shrinks over time.
Like Jell-O, again, another tasty cosmic phenomenon. So
exactly right.
We talked about cosmic fossils. We've talked about Jupiter. What is particularly exciting to you in the realm of scientific discoveries from Hubble over the past few weeks or months, let's say?
One of the things that Hubble has recently found by looking in some of its deep fields, you know, some of my favorite Hubble images are these deep fields where Hubble just stares at some direction of deep space and collects light for a long time so that the faintest objects show up. And that usually yields a whole set of distant galaxies. And we've seen them flicker a little bit. And what does that flickering mean? Well, it means that these are episodes when these distant galaxies, which, as I mentioned earlier, we know now most of them have these supermassive black holes in the core. These supermassive black holes are basically gobbling up stuff that gets too close. And if a nearby star or a cloud of gas falls into that central black hole, falling in, or even to the accretion disk of material around the black hole, stuff falling into that can create a flash of visible light. And Hubble has been monitoring some of these distant galaxies for some time and finding that they see some of these flickers of light in these distant galaxies, which really are signposts of their inner black holes swallowing up material. But not only that, they're finding more of these flickering episodes than were expected. So it means that we're finding with Hubble more black holes in the early universe than had previously been known or reported. We're also doing some innovative things with Hubble. Recently, we looked at Uranus, which we've looked at many times with Hubble, but we did it in concert with the New Horizons probe. I don't know if you remember the New Horizons probe. It went past Pluto. Actually, Hubble helped it do that. But since then, New Horizons has gone beyond Pluto. It studied objects out in the Kuiper Belt beyond Pluto. And it turned back and looked at Uranus while Hubble was looking at Uranus. So we could kind of see what it looks like if you're looking at an object like New Horizons was and only getting one or two pixels of information. And then with Hubble, we get a lot of detail. And so we could kind of compare that. Hubble's kind of like our ground truth. And now we know kind of what to expect when we look out in the future to an exoplanet system where we may only get a pixel or two of an image, but we have some sense of ground truth because of the comparisons we did looking at Uranus with Hubble, where you get a lot of detail, and comparing that with the one or two pixels we got from New Horizons looking at it. But also recently, Hubble has teamed up with MAVEN. MAVEN is a mission to Mars, and both of them were measuring the amount of leftover hydrogen in Mars' atmosphere, trying to understand what happened to Mars' water. You know, we know that Mars used to have a lot of liquid water on its surface. We can see the leftover riverbeds and lake beds. And now, when we go to Mars with our probes and rovers, all we find is a frozen wasteland, dry riverbeds, dry lake beds, and of course, under the surface dirt, we find some frozen frost and some water ice at the poles. What happened to Mars' water? We know that it's climate change, that Mars has become cold and it's lost much of its atmosphere, but we know that a lot of it evaporated, and what MAVEN and Hubble have done is measure a ratio of something called deuterium, which is called heavy hydrogen, and basic hydrogen in the atmosphere. Deuterium and hydrogen come free and apparent when water molecules that evaporated get into Mars' atmosphere. They become dissociated when they are hit by radiation. And so then you have your oxygen separated from your hydrogen. And some of that hydrogen is in the form of deuterium. So it's kept its neutron. And some of it is just basically without that second mass in its nucleus. And the ratio of deuterium to hydrogen tells you something about how long evaporation has been going on of these dissociated water molecules. This is basically telling us that Mars water evaporated over time, as we expect, but that that evaporation rate may have been very closely connected to solar activity, that when the sun was active, there would be a lot more of this dissociation, and when the sun was less active. This is a very different realm now, but looking way outside of our own galaxy into a very active galaxy called M87. It's a galaxy that has a really massive active black hole in its core. And what happens is that as material is falling into this circling accretion disk around that black hole in the core of M87, some of it gets entangled with the magnetic fields that are very strong around the core of that galaxy. And that ends up causing them to be launched like a jet outside of this black hole. In fact, these jets are seen whenever we have something accreting something. Often we see a kind of an exhaust jet coming out. Well, the jets coming out of active galactic nuclei can be really powerful. In fact, they can reach far beyond the edge of the galaxy itself, and they can be like little pencil beams moving out into intergalactic space. And with material going being launched at nearly the speed of light, so these are really powerful phenomena. What Hubble has discovered about lately about the jet coming out of the black hole region of M87 is that all around that jet, within the galaxy, in the environment right around the jet, not inside the jet, but next to it, we see a lot of these stellar novae. These are star explosions. What is going on that would cause a jet like this to actually stir up more of these novae explosions in the environment? We're not sure, but we think that these jets are stirring up gas in the galaxy as they whiz by, and that actually adds more fuel to some of these special kinds of stars that are really binary stars. If this supermassive black hole jet is nearby, it may be stirring up a lot more gas and pushing a lot more material onto that companion star, which accelerates this nova explosion phenomenon. So, you know, this is just speculation, but we do see a lot more of these novae explosions from these binary star pairs all along the environments of the M87 jet than we see anywhere else in the M87 galaxy.
We've been speaking with Jennifer Wiseman. She's the Hubble Space Telescope Senior Project Scientist, talking about some of the really cool findings from Hubble over these past few months. Jennifer, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Anytime.
That's going to do it for this week's show. If you're not already, be sure to subscribe to the show's podcast feed so you never miss an episode. Do that on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, wherever you get your podcasts. Stay connected with the show. Follow us on social media. We're on Instagram and Facebook, AEWTY Space. And if you got an idea for a future episode of the show, or you want to join us as a guest, reach out to us via email. We're at arewetherayet@cfpublic.org. More space coverage always online. Visit cfpublic.org/space. Are We There Yet? This is a production of Central Florida Public Media. Our producer is Marion Summerall. Our intern is Jenna Weiss. Editorial guidance from Latoya Dennis. Support for Are We There Yet comes from our listeners. Until next week, I'm Brendan Byrne. Thanks for listening.